In the light. Oh, you all be light now. I'm telling you, that's the way to begin this Christmas season in the Bahamas. Don't tell them Jesus is the light of the world. It's not about the Christmas tree and the gifts and some of the very sad things we heard about Black Friday with people scrapping and causing all kind of confusion over material things. If they understood that Jesus, that this Christmas is about Jesus, they would have shown love and compassion and sensitivity to each other, even as they stand on the line to do some dangerous shopping. As we said earlier, today is Family Day. And I just want you to do something for me. If you're here today with your family, just look at your family. Look at them and tell them you love them. Tell them thank you, thank God for you, every single one. If they're a little far in the audience, you can even use sign language. This says, I love you. This is the L, the I, L, and the Y. I love you. Send your hand to them. Tell them. See them over there. I love you. Philip, I see no I love you on the stage, man. What's the deal? She even ain't looking. But listen to me. You gotta thank God for your family. If you're a husband like me and God has blessed you with wife and children, thank God. Thank God for them. And children, thank God for your parents. All the children say amen. Amen. Thank you very much. Even as we begin a couple of remarks about our family day, I just want to highlight for your just for your appreciation. We heard about Brandon this past week. And I believe that the angels were there. If you heard about what happened, the cars, I understood it, spin over a couple of times, ended up, I don't know what side or the head or whatever, and Brandon was able to walk away with a couple of scratches before the car caught a fire. Now you tell me, that's something to be grateful for. And today we're talking about loss, so that's an opportunity to thank God that there was no loss. And unfortunately, there's another category of persons who were not so fortunate this very same week. And I think of the Haitians. More than 30 of them, we understand, lost their lives at sea. The others stranded on the boat, waiting to be rescued by the Coast Guard and the Bahamas Royal Bahamas Defense Force. That story did not have such a very happy ending. It was very tragic. And we're encouraging you to feel the compassion for others and to hold them up before the Lord. Today, as we think about this subject, we're thinking of loss of relationships. It creates a lot of stress. Loss of health, loss of work, loss through death. And this one for me is really one that really brings about a loss of hope. There's so many people who don't have any hope because of whatever they've experienced. But today, we're going to talk about that. The goal is to raise the awareness that death is not the only form of loss that we experience and acknowledge that people grieve over various forms of losses that can be quite traumatic. We've invited Dr. Timothy Barrett to be with us today to help us articulate the various types of loss that can be experienced, the uniqueness of the experience, and the variety of ways that we can support each other. At the end of the day, we want you as a congregation to feel a sense of hope that as you grieve through your various forms of losses, that there's hope. We also want you to embrace the opportunity to provide encouragement, caring support, and help for other persons in the church and in the community as they grieve through their experiences, and to receive the comfort and healing that only we know that a solid relationship with Jesus Christ can provide. Job 14 and 1 and 2 says, how frail is humanity? How short is life? How full of trouble. We blossom like a flower, then we wither. Like a passing shadow, we quickly disappear. I encourage you. There's a song that's been in my soul all week as I think about this topic. Will your anchor hold through the storms of life? When the clouds unfold their wings of strife, will your strong tides lift and the cables strain? Will your anchor hold? Firm remain, adrift or firm remain. We have an anchor that what? Keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. fastened to the rock, which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. It's our prayer that you experience that form of that experience today as we go through this issue. Now we have chosen, we know that life's experiences are so precious to us, and we have three precious persons that we've invited to come and speak to us about their experiences, and we're going to invite them to share how they've gone through their experiences of loss and how the Lord has kept them and held them together and given them hope as they endure it. And so we have Brother Carvel Wallace, Sister Ruth Demerit, and Brother Ricardo Stubbs. And we can invite them to come and share their testimonies with us. You know, as I said to Carvel this morning, you ready? He said, no. But you know, you can never really be ready for things like this. But we know that he has a God, and he has the Holy Spirit that strengthened and helped him and guided him through his experience. So Carvel, I invite you to come at this point. Give him a hand as he comes. Yeah.
Morning. I don't know why they picked me first, but anyway. To lose something, you had to have it. And everything that we have, that we treasure or not, was given to us by God. And we find it easy to praise him when he gives us stuff. But that same praise that we give him when he gives us stuff, we got to still give that to him when he takes it away. And if we call ourselves Christians, we have to remember that he is our Heavenly Father, and if he takes something away from us, he is doing it because he loves us. And I know that's easier said than to receive, but we can only accept being Christian when it's good. God doesn't change, and our praise for him should never stop. When the loss comes about, it's so easy to ask the question, why? And I could guarantee you, if you ask the question why, the answer you came up with is probably wrong. I think the posture we should have is, I don't know why, but because you are my God and you are my Father, I'll trust that what you're doing is the best thing for me. Thank you for the time that I've had what I've had, and I still want to praise you even though you've taken it away. I lost my wife of almost 10 years, and I'd say my best friend for 14 years. I found that I never could put myself in a place to say why, because I'm trusting that God knew what he was doing. But I found that, I mean, and that's just one thing that everybody in the church knows. I've lost so much other things before, and all that stuff, that I've taken the posture that no matter what it is, I'm not going to lose my praise. And thankfully enough, it's Christmas time. It's time to think about all the wonderful things there is. God has been really good to me. He gave me a new wife. new mother for my children. So again, the blessing keeps coming. And again, we need to praise him. And whenever he takes something away, let's thank him for what we've had when we had it. And still praise him as the same God that gave it to us. And until that glorious day that we go to see him, we just have to trust that whatever he does is well done. And I wanted a song played, but I can play a little piece from the back there. So Lex, you could, this was kind of my theme. I hope it got through.
Thank you very much, Carvel. And you know, even as we recognize that we share these experiences as a community, Carvel lost his wife 2 years ago. Sister Joy was a member of our fellowship. And we shared with, along with Carvel and the Wallace family and Anna and Nathan and that experience. And God is good. And we are to continue to place our trust in him. Sister Ruth Demerit is going to share her testimony of God's goodness. See, Ruth, you're free to use that podium or come up here if they can see you a little better. You comfortable there? That's fine.
Thank you, Stuart. Good morning, church. Some of you may remember, and many of you may not. I have to read so I could stay focused. December 27th of this year, we'll make 21 years since my son, Richard Demerit Jr., was murdered. He had just returned home from university after qualifying as a chartered accountant. I will not go into the lack of a trial for his murder or no conviction of the persons who were responsible, nor the loss of all the information regarding his death by the courts and a denial of the normal rights of a person born in this country to the family, to a family who had served it well. Now, I am not the only one in this church who suffered this fate. Sister Helen Turnquest and Sister Geneva Jolly, whose sons grew up in this church just like mine, also suffered the hatred and venom of murderous young men in our country. And there may also be others here who could relate to this. At that time, I asked the Lord many questions. Can't say like I didn't do it. Like, why, Lord, have you allowed my son to be killed and left on the street like a dead dog? How could you let the persons responsible for this walk free? Did I not ask you over and over from he was a child to protect him? How could you not protect him when he was your child too? Do you still love me? And what have I done to deserve this cruelty? I decided then, I didn't bring my handkerchief, and I thought I wouldn't do that. I decided then that I had to find answers from God himself. So I embarked upon a search of the Bible, God's own words, for truths and promises which I could cling to in order to keep my sanity and strengthen my faith. I searched up words like murder, justice, revenge, hatred, forgiveness, and other words in that connection. I also read many books by persons who had suffered loss of their children to see how they handled their death. I was curious about what happened when you die and what the Bible said about heaven and hell, because Satan was trying to convince me to doubt the salvation of my son, even though he left a written record of what he believed. The year following his death, I watched Christian TV from morning till night. And one day I needed an explanation of 1 John 3:19-20. Because Satan was attacking me with condemnation, and my heart was trying to deceive me. I could not find anyone from this church to help me. I called Brother Marcel, I called Rudolph Cartwright, and I called you too, Cyril Pete. But I couldn't get anyone on the telephone. So I prayed to the Lord and I asked God to have someone interpret the voice for me. The next preacher who came on the TV took his text from those same verses. When he was finished, I told Satan, "You are a liar." One thing I proved that day and became confident of was that God heard my prayers. At the end of that year, all the research I had done, I made some decisions and concluded that the first thing I had to do was to forgive the murderer. Because if I expected God to forgive me, Colossians 3:13 and Matthew 6:14 confirmed this. It was not easy for me to do it, but I did it. I discovered too that after I forgave the young man and all those connected, I did not have that awful pain of anger and hatred which burned in my heart all year long. I had finally found some peace of mind. The second discovery in Genesis 4:10 was the fact that my son's own blood cries out to the Lord for revenge, just like Abel's. So I did not have to seek revenge myself. But it will surprise you to know how many persons offered to take revenge for me. Then in Romans 12:19, God himself asked me to leave room for his wrath, because vengeance belonged to him and he will repay. Thirdly, Proverbs 11:21 confirmed that I would get justice, because it says the wicked will be punished and no one goes unpunished. As for hatred, I did, and sometimes I still do struggle with that, particularly when I run into a certain lawyer who maliciously spoke of the character of my son. I always have to remind myself of John 3:15, which says, "If you hate your brother, you are just like a murderer." Pray for me, because I repent often because of him. And sometimes, just recently, I ran into him in the elevator coming down the elevator of the courts. And guess what he was saying when he walked in? He was quoting a scripture verse. And I said, boy, demons know how to quote scripture. I said, look at you coming in here quoting scripture. Who you think you're talking to? I have tried not to become bitter over the years. I don't ask God foolish questions anymore. I told him to show me how he would take care of it. I prayed constantly that he would save the souls of those persons who were involved. Someone told me that time would heal the wounds, and that is true. It has been a long time, but the loss of a child never really go away. We just continue living with all the memories we have of them. I still cry, but I don't cry as one without hope. I continue to trust God, because I know he is the great judge of all the world, and he always do what is right. God knows all the emotions we feel when adversity comes, no matter what it is. For some of you, it may be divorce or something else. Because we were made in his image, and men did the same thing to his only son, Jesus Christ, when he suffered on the cross for us. Although God could have prevented his death, he didn't do it. He allowed it so that we may inherit the awesome gift of eternal life. And for that, I am grateful.
Thank you very much, Sister Ruth. And of course, we're going to follow it with Ricardo Stubbs. But I want to put Pastor Lyle on notice that immediately after Ricardo, I'd like Carvel and Sister Ruth to return. Sister Ruth, immediately after Ricardo, I'd like you to return. And we're going to have Pastor Lyle just pray specifically about those testimonies and what the Holy Spirit kind of can be use it. And I understand that we do have some others. Sister Ruth mentioned Sister Helen and Sister Geneva Jolly, but I understand Brother Van Fowler is also in that very same category. So this church has had its share of that awful experience, and we want to cement these very holy moments, I call them, with prayer with Pastor Lyle after Ricardo. Thank you.
Good morning. I really feel good this morning. You all don't know how good I feel. Jesus, the light of the world. Love it. He is the light of the world. And I came by to let you know today, folks. You see people every day and you see them going through and they look good in their clothes, look good dressed up. But you know something? All of us have some problems and some Job experiences. And I had a Job experience. Something I'd like to share with you this morning. I've had my losses, but I took them like a man. You know, I lost my first marriage to divorce. Lost my mind to drugs and alcohol. Lost my father to kidney failure. Lost my brother to cancer. It's right after one another, you know. Lost my son to kidney failure. Lost my mother the kidney failure and cancer. Now, I could be, you know, testimonies. They give me 5 minutes, they tell me to talk about testimony. But let me tell you about the glory and the goodness of God. You see, Sister Ruth and Brother Brother Carl Wallace, I wanted you to know that there's light on the other side of darkness. You see, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6 says this: trust in the Lord with all thy heart and lean not unto your own understanding. Acknowledge him in all thy ways, not some, all thy ways, and he will direct your path. You see, God directed my path from the darkness, all the pain, all the sorrows, all the hurt. It was a time before I would stand up here and cry, but there's no more tears, there's no more hurt, there's no more pain. It's nothing like the grace and the love of Jesus Christ. You see, I came by to tell you, I serve a good God who loves me, and he is willing to take you from all circumstances and put you in a place that you could never understand. You see, the very people that I've lost, I started off by telling you I lost the marriage, but God gave me a beautiful wife. I mean, hey, one that you can't even describe. God gave me a beautiful wife. I lost my father, but God gave me some spiritual fathers. He gave me Pastor Lyle. He gave me Brother Greg Williams. He gave me Cyril Pete. God started giving me spiritual men. You see, I lost my brother, but God has a way of giving you back. He gave me Charles Seeley. He gave me Tony Wilson. He gave me Avery Lightbine. I could go all day telling you what the brothers God has given to me. You see, I've lost the son, but God given me, still have me with my own sons. I could tell you about Kiero. I could tell you about Kedrick. I could tell you about Rio. I could tell you about Ricky. But I could tell you about a spiritual son that I have adopted, Hansi Laxador, who is now my spiritual brother, my spiritual son. I could tell you about some things that God has been doing for me. You see, we came by today with sorrow. Some of you got some sorrows, but I want to tell you about the glory and the goodness of God. You see, my mother went away, but God gave me Sister Doreen. God gave me Sister Kelly. God gave me Sister Helen. God gave me Sister Adley. I could go all day and tell you about the people that God has given to me. You see, there's a scripture that I love so much. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, what tells you that eyes have not seen the things that God has prepared for your life. You see, the human ears have not heard what God has prepared for you in your life. You see, God said the human mind cannot even conceive the things that God has prepared for you in your life. Trust in the Lord. You see, there's a man called Jesus. You see, there's power in the name of Jesus. Power, power, power.
I'm looking for Cabo. Hey, Cabo. And of course, Brother Van, I'd like you to join us. I know that the loss is pervasive. Yeah, I remember. The loss is pervasive, but we're talking particularly the categories that of people who have lost the loved one through murder, and there's been no justice. So I want them to join. And your mother-in-law, right? Sister Cynthia? Is she here? Right, Sister Cynthia.
We're going to have the elders join us up here as well.
Yeah, right. And if you're here today and you're visiting and you are in that category, the Lord has you here for a reason. You're free to join us for this same prayer time. We want to cement those testimonies and particularly to hold up
Brother
this
Richard,
issue.
Brother Richard DeMarie?
Yeah, Richard, yes. Yes, please Richard, we'd like you to join us. Any other elders? We want the elders to support.
Church, if God has just given you a three-part sermon, that loss, though not the original part of creation, has now been woven into the tapestry of God's sovereignty, that loss becomes an occasion for us to see the glory of God, despite all that the enemy can do, what he meant for evil, God always turns around and weaves that into our good. We can trust this sovereign God. The scriptures are quite clear that there is nothing that can take place in our lives that God is not able to weave that into the tapestry of his good and perfect will for us. And we can trust all that comes our way because God is sovereign, God is good, and God is in control despite the short leash that he gives the devil to work as his agent in refining the saints. Shall we look to this God? Please join hands, hold on to somebody, love them up, to Brother Carvel, Sister Ruth, and Brother Ricardo. You have blessed us mightily today, and that you have shown us that any loss that we have had pales and is no excuse for us to be held captive, moping and depressed, because God is sovereign. Let's look to the Lord, shall we? Yeah, hold hands in the audience. We're in this together. Father, we bring ourselves to you, a sovereign and a good God. Oh God, you've told us in your scripture that there is nothing too hard for you to do. Shall anything in life, shall death, shall angels, principalities, is there anything in life that can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus? Lord, when we look around and see injustices, when we look around and see the wrongs and evils that seem, Lord, to go unpunished in this life, we sometimes despair and think that perhaps our appreciation for what the scriptures tell us about you is not true. But then, Lord, we, as the psalmist says, then he went into the temple and he beheld the Lord. And Lord, when we look at Calvary, the injustice of Calvary, the cruelness of Calvary, the wickedness that took place, that the sinless Son of God was rejected, denied, whipped, scorned, beaten, nailed to a cross, and utterly rejected. And yet, Lord, in that, we see the plan of God unfold. The scriptures tell us, if the rulers of this age had known, they would not have done that to the Son of God. They would not have initiated such a cruel endeavor against the Son of God. But in the evilness of this world's ruler, the devil and all of his minions, in their evilness and vileness and wickedness, the plan of God came into full effect. For by his wounds we are healed. Lord, and we see that it was not an accident of history, but we hear the scriptures that before the world began, it is the apostle says, we see Jesus crucified before the world began. So Lord, you knew what was going to happen. You knew what would take place. And you planned even in the evil that would come our way, that you would bring forth our good. And Lord, with that, we thank you that you have brought forth the Holy Spirit, who comforts us in all of our sorrows, that we may be comforted by him and turn around and use that comfort to comfort others. Comfort Carvel in his loss. Thank you that in his loss, though he would never fully be rid of that, you've given him a beautiful companion, and he still has his children, his mother and father, and sisters, and a whole church community that loves him and will be there for him. For Sister Ruth, who has lost a son and yet has many sons. For Richard, Lord, his namesake taken from him. Lord, for the girls, for Tina and for Indira, Lord, who have lost their brother. We pray that you would continue to undertake and supply your grace without limit on their lives. Lord, continue, we pray, to give her mercy as she would deal with this lawyer that she mentioned, Lord, who the devil is using to test her faith, but whom you're using to try her faith and bring it forth as gold. Be with him. Lord, for the powerful testimony that Ricardo gave, Lord, that in all of his losses, there's gain. In all of his losses, he sees the glory of God. And Lord, so therefore we bring Sister Helen and Brother Van and Sister Geneva Jolly and Sister Seeley and Sandra Smith and all the others, Lord, who have a powerful loss like these murders in their family life. Continue, Lord, to bring grace and favor and sustain them in their time of need. Now then, Lord, we commit ourselves to you and pray that you would continue to be an ever-present God in times of trouble, bringing us, Lord, a sense of satisfaction that for all that we've gone through, it does not compare with the riches and the glory that is to come. In these things, we set our hope, and we bless you and thank you in Christ's name.
Okay, let's say thank you, Lord. All I make it say is, when the Lord provides that kind of food for your spirit, you gotta say thank you. I invite you to even share in your thanks as we stand in this congregational song. Invite Elder Pete to come. Come, thou long expected Jesus. We share in that.
Let's all stand as we continue our worship together. I'd just like to draw to your attention words in the third stanza of this song. We have new words. New words given to us by Pastor Hannah. So just look out for them as we get to that stanza. I also, following this worship moment, Elder Michael Hanna and the praise team will be encouraging all our hearts with special music. Come, thou long expected Jesus.
Come, thou long expected Jesus. Let us find our rest in
one more time, just so you can get the feel of it. It ties right in with the spirit of what we are doing today. And hear these words. I'll read them out for those who may not have had them register. Come and free us from our sadness, from our grief, and from our pain. Fill our hearts again with gladness. Help us sing with joy again. By thy power and by thy mercy, Holy Spirit, frame us well. Of your wonder and your glory, our lips to all the world shall tell. You got an amen in you? That's a good place for an amen. Third from the top.
Come and free us from our sadness, from our grief, and from our pain. Fill our hearts again with gladness. Help us sing with joy again.
To find peace, security. Do you fall into despair and lose your way? There's just one thing I will say as I sing this song today. That's Jesus is the light of the world.
Sing it if you know it.
Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus, he is the light of the world.
When all to find peace,
security.
Do you fall into despair and lose your way? There's just one thing I will say as I sing this song today, that Jesus
the light of the world.
Tell me who is on your side when your back's against the wall. Is there someone there to help you break your fall? What you need from God above is a Savior full of love. That's Jesus, the light of the world.
Just stand, let me say amen. Thank the Lord for the gift of music written by Elder Sarge and Pastor Hannah today.
As Elder Pete said, that song was written by Elder Michael Hannah, and I think it's also on an album, right? So this Christmas, I mean, let the people think that you're a little crazy riding your car, dancing to Sarge music. Jesus is the light of the world. But I think this is the second time this message is coming through that Jesus is the light of the world. You think the demons got that message? That it ain't them, it ain't Satan, that Jesus is the light that we're holding up to give people a sense of hope even as they go through their various life challenges. Amen. I'm going to invite another family to come and share the welcome for us. So Charlene Ferguson, and Charlene is going to introduce this beautiful young lady standing next to her to us. I know you all think you all know who she is.
Good morning. Yes, I'm Charlene Wallace Ferguson. It's my pleasure to have my daughter, Symphony Wallace Ferguson, welcome you here this morning. She has been giving me instructions, though, so I love to follow them as best as I can. This morning, we don't have a lot of visitors listed here. So I just go ahead. First of all, we want to welcome the family of Sister Lorraine Hanna.
Can you stand, please?
Ask for any other visitors whose names are not listed.
Are there any other visitors here whose names are not listed? Can you stand for us, please?
Well, you preempted us because we were about to say, can you give them a grace welcome for us, please? And we are happy to see Jackie and Zoanne with us. It's wonderful to have you here. They were with us previously as members, so happy to see you. And we also want to give a special welcome to Dr. Timothy Byard and his family. He is our guest speaker for this morning. And we see that he certainly was enjoying all this music that was going on this morning. We want to take this opportunity to welcome you once again to our service. Today, normally we would have a special meal prepared for you, just an hors d'oeuvre kind of thing after the service. But today, y'all are extra, extra special. Tell them, Symphony.
You get a whole meal.
So it's not just light refreshments today. We're inviting you visitors to please join us. Today is Family Day. And so we're asking you to join us in the Herbert Trico Fellowship Hall, right here to my right, after the service to join us for a meal so you can fellowship with us. Please, Grace, give them a welcome again and tell them, show them how happy we are to have them.
Are we asking to show them? What are we going to do that?
We don't know, so there's a new baby in our midst.
We have a new baby. Yay!
Well, the baby is not here with us. I know that's not going to be a very happy thing in one respect for Brother Colin, because he always likes to see this list of expectant mothers increase.
Are you happy now?
But we want to go ahead this week to Wendy and Andolino. The beautiful Amaris was born. So mother, baby, and father are home well.
She's 8 pounds, 6 ounces.
We also want to now go ahead, and there's another special time we come to in our service. That's when we go ahead and welcome, we go ahead and talk about all the anniversaries and the birthdays. So, we're going to go through the birthdays for the week.
On the 7th, we have Eric Tai, Crystal Ramming, Brandon Kem, and Saray Rogers. Can you stand for us, please?
On December 6th, we have Cherie Scott.
On the 5th, we have Mr. Douglas Jinder Turnquest. And
Jonay Bowles.
On the 4th, we have Kendrick Stubbs and Tavano Bowles.
On the 3rd, we have Nalda Williams and Patrice Ramming.
And today, rounding out that list are
Raven Kelly and Judith Ellis.
So if you see these people this week, or just go ahead and take the time to give them a call to say happy birthday. We're going to do the birthday jingle for them.
You forgot the anniversaries.
Oh, the anniversaries. See, there, I told you she's giving me instructions. Who are the anniversary symphony?
We have Allison and Tanya Gilbert on the 6th of December.
Now we'll have the birthday jingle.
Okay, go ahead.
door.
By Charlene to remain, we have one more task for Charlene that she's not aware of. But I want you to join me in showing appreciation to Charlene as the director of the Aesthetics Ministry. We saw the fantastic thing during the independence, and look how beautiful this place has looked for our Christmas season. She's the director, she's the head, the person in charge. But I want her to identify some of the other members of her team.
I could not do it without the wonderful team that I actually had supporting me. So all of this is the result of Melody Hannah, Farrell Knowles, Gabby Knowles, Shasta Major, Shirley Sweeting, Rohan Kerr, Tony Wilson assisted us also. Little Andre Major also assisted us. Wendell Munnings. Oh, Jasmine was also helping us. And we appreciate your contribution too, okay? That made it a lot easier. Did I leave anybody out? I don't want to do that.
Baby Jazz, he was here all
week. Oh, Baby Jazz. Baby Jazz certainly gave us wonderful support.
And he didn't even cry.
No, he didn't cry. No, he was an excellent supporter. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Charlene and Symphony. You did a fantastic job. And you see how well coordinated they were? Man, I tell you. I'm full of those Wallace Ferguson girls. All right. We're now going to invite Pastor Hannah to join us. As you know, I'm going to steal his thunder. Come, Pastor Hannah. We have an important task that he's got to deliver today.
Yes, I was wondering what Stuart was calling me up here for, but now I remember. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a very powerful ministry that happens in this church, and it is ongoing. It is a ministry that helps persons in the church and persons outside of the church. It has been going on, and recently it has been led by a committee of persons. It was led originally by our brother Vicente Roberts. He's no longer with us, but he began the building of the ministry, and we are very grateful for the building work that he did. And then he left it to a group of persons who have been leading it as a group, Pastor Marcel, Sister Doreen, Sister Kelly, Sister Camille, who have continued the ministry. And we are very grateful for the way they kept things going for such a long time. But of course, we are gathering now another vision for the ministry, and it will continue. And recently, the PCB has approved the appointment of a director for the ministry. And extremely, we are so fortunate to have a woman of her caliber to be able to, and training and background and experience to be able to lead this ministry. And I want to ask you to please welcome Sister Camille Smith, who is our new director of counseling. Please come, Camille. You know, they have this thing that everything Pastor Anna is in charge of, he always put a pretty lady to lead it. You saw Charlene was leader of the aesthetic team, right? And the list go on, but that's not really true. And Allison is head of the ushers, as he just reminded me. Pretty leaders. Come, Camille, please come. Yeah, yes, thank you, Lisa. I was just about to explain. It's just that there are beautiful ladies in this church, so anyone I pick. You know, I could throw a rock anywhere in this church and it'll hit a pretty girl. Don't try it out with me, Lisa. Camille, we are so happy that you've taken on the responsibility of leading perhaps one of the most precious ministries of the church, because you deal with people's souls, you deal with people's secrets, you deal with people's pain, and we couldn't think of someone better to lead it, and we're happy to introduce you to the church. Would you now let them know who some of your team members will be? And she will be coming back to you early in the new year to tell you some more about where this ministry is going. But for right now, I just wanted to introduce some of the principles of a team.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. As we live and breathe, we sometimes experience pain, right? Yes. And in that pain, sometimes it's a good thing to do, to be able to have someone else to go and speak with, to pray with, to minister to your spirit, to your needs, to help you perhaps to see maybe a little different perspective that may help to relieve some of that. That is what the counseling ministry is about. We want to be able to provide a service and continue to provide that service for people to come and share, for people to come and explore, and primarily for people to come and grow. Grow through the experience that you may be going through. The persons who will be continuing to work in the counseling ministry with me, of course, will be Sister Doreen, and she is away at the moment. There's Sister Bernice Kelly, and would you please come, Sister Kelly? There is Brother Andy Knowles, who will be assisting. Of course, we also have continuing is Elder Stuart Kelly, who will be continuing. We also have Pastor Marcel. I didn't see him this morning, but he was aware that he was going to be called. And also Mel Smith. I'm not sure Mel is here, but if he is, could you please come, Mel? We will also be looking for other persons to join us in this team, because we have some plans to organize and regularize and provide a regular type of clinic setting, lay counseling clinic setting in the future. So if you feel so inclined, if you feel gifted, if you have these particular skills, and if you are interested in serving, please do see me.
As the pastor responsible for counseling in the church, I would just like to pray for my team and our new director. Lord, as we come into this season, we're reminded one of your names is Wonderful Counselor. And Father, you've given gifts of counseling to people. You've given them healing gifts, caring gifts. And Father, we just thank you that you've placed persons like this under our care to be able to minister to the hurting, to the searching, to those who need clarity. We thank you for these gifts. They will help many. Father, we ask your blessing on them, particularly as they put their plans together now. Father, you know they have some lofty goals. But obviously, Father, they believe that there's nothing too difficult for you. And so, Father, we pray that you would bless Camille, bless her team, bless their goals as they go forward as healing ministers of your church. We thank you for them in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Go ahead.
I would also like to acknowledge the assistance of many of the elders, many of the PCB, and to let them know we'll be calling on you, and thank you very much for continuing.
Thank you. And I trust that you would give this team your full support and embrace the opportunity for God to allow you to be ministered to in your time of need. We are going to move to our church news, just a few news items we want to highlight. And there's a very special production coming up in the month of December, and we're going to ask Pastor Hannah to just tell you all about it.
Elder McCarty, please come quickly. I am so happy that after 30-something-odd years of pulling together the Christmas musical, the Lord has grown some young people who love him very deeply, and they have decided, Pastor Ann, I think you kind of need a break. Plus, I think they think I'm getting a little bit stale, and that's all right. That's all right. And we have Naldo Williams and Christy, not McCarty, Christy Cawley, who have taken on the leadership of the Christmas musical. And of course, they're being greatly assisted by Sister Stephanie Hannah with choreography and with Sisters Teresa Williams and Rochelle Seeley with the children's choir. So you see, there are a whole team of persons working to make this an excellent musical. Now, as you know, the musical is to raise funds for missions. And so the musical will run over 3 nights, beginning Friday, December 20th, Saturday, the 21st, and Sunday, the 22nd. That will be our special Christmas celebration. And tickets will be on sale beginning today, and I'm going to call Elder Cardinal McCarty about that. And right after he's done, I have one closing word. So, Elder McCarty.
Good afternoon. The tickets will be available all day during the meal and just as you come out. Now, the tickets are $5 per day or per night. But we also have like a Black Friday special. For those who want to come all 3 nights or 2 of the 3 nights, you can pay $8 for two, $10 for 3 nights. So $5 each, and you can see me afterwards. Thank you.
Now about that, remember the addition of this particular musical is we're also going to use it to send people to take the gospel later on this summer. Don't you think that's a wonderful blend of ideas? Huh? And so here's the thing. It's not prohibitive. It's $5. You know, you need at least $6 to get a combo at Wendy's. It's $5. And I want to give you an idea. Catch the special. You got to buy gifts for all of those nieces and nephews. Give them a real treat. A night of music, a night of drama, a night of laughter. Get the bundle, you know, and give them, and then they go home with the message of the gospel in their hearts, you know. Grace, we've got to fill the church for 3 nights. And I think we can do that. I think we can do that. We have to encourage our young people and let them know we are absolutely, positively behind them. And since you don't have to spend the many hours in practice and rehearsal and so on and so forth, all you do is make sure that we bring people and fill this chapel every night for the production. Thank you. Oh, finally, what is happening this Wednesday at 6:30? What is happening this Wednesday at 6:30? Well, our prayer is going to be very special this week. Our focus will continue. We will come together and we will pray for the hurting among us this coming Wednesday. So you have to be here. We want to give them comfort. That's what we are here for, to comfort one another. So please, 6:30, I've been telling you the last 3 weeks, I hope you've made all of the arrangements. Come straight here, make the sacrifice, and let us pray for one another this coming Wednesday. Thank you.
Just to underscore what Pastor Hannah just said, we've deliberately determined that this prayer service coming up on Wednesday would be a follow-up to today, where we know that we are stirring some emotions and some issues, and there's loss, tremendous loss by members of this congregation. And we encourage you to come out on Wednesday at 6:30 and experience a time of prayer as we ask God to comfort you. But if you're not in a particular category, but you know of somebody, maybe you can invite them to come along with you, or you come on their behalf, just, you know, intercede on their behalf during our prayer time, that God would heal and strengthen through the various forms of loss that we will be speaking about today. We want to remind you about the Christmas love offering envelopes. They were given out from last Sunday and again today, and we've determined December 15th is the Sunday when we want to be able to collect them. You can give them in before, but December 15th is the focus point for the love offering, and we encourage you to give generously as the Lord has given to you. Amen? All right. And we want to also remind you of the initiatives being led by Breakaway, particularly with the Christmas tree ornaments as part of our fellowship time. As a family, you can come up with an ornament, design an ornament yourself, purchase one, put the family name on it, on the tree, it will give attention to it. They have ornaments available. You can purchase one if you don't have one for your family, or whatever. There's the initiative for the Gospel for Asia and gifts being given in that area as well. So I encourage you to see the table at the end. See that after the service, you have to pass it in order to get to the mealtime. So just stop by the table and govern yourselves accordingly. So we're saying we want to move along, and we move now to our offering time. And we also have another family that's going to come and share this offering experience for us. So I invite the Roys to come. This is Mr. Howard Roy, and he has two beautiful girls and two handsome gentlemen along with him. And he's going to tell us, why did they happen to look so much like him? Of course, except the wife. The wife, she's prettier. Come, Mr. Roy.
Good morning, church. I am Howard Roy, as you've been told, and I know some of you don't believe it. These three kids belong to her, us. I know she looks a lot younger than she really is. So this is Tina, my wife. My firstborn, Dale, second, David, and my princess, Denise. That means I am a king, right? All right, we're here to do the offertory covenant. Could you please stand for us? Covenant is taken from Proverbs 3, 9 and 10, Luke 6, verse 38. For those of you who don't have a bulletin or don't know it yet, it is up there. Let us begin together. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your substance. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Let us pray. Our eternal God and Father, we are so thankful, Lord, for your many blessings. Father, we know we take many of them for granted, and we ask that you'll forgive us for our shortcomings. Father, as we come before you to give back some of what you've given to us, we ask, Father, that you'll take it, you'll bless it, and you'll make it do what we couldn't do with it. Father, we pray that the results might be manifold, and that many might come to know you through our gifts. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Thank you to the Roy family for your participation. Of course, we are anxious to experience a little more pointedly regarding our plan for today. And just before we have Pastor Lyle come and present our speaker to us, I want to remind you that again, we're here for lunch. And so it's a little extended. We started an hour earlier today, but we're going to feed you. We're going to make sure that you don't leave here hungry today, but encourage you to remain behind and share in that meal experience with us. And just before the speaker, we will allow the children to be dismissed, but not just yet. And we want you to know, particularly if you're visiting today and you brought your children along, our time of sharing on this subject is really geared toward, we've just particularly looking at grade children and grade 7 and up. If you have a child in grade 6 and below, I did it already. Grade 6 and below, we want you to allow them to experience what has been prepared for, you know, age appropriate, prepared for them. So when the other children leave, you allow your children to leave as well. Grade 7, up to the adults, we remain in the sanctuary. But at this point, I'd like to invite Sister Camille to come again. And she'll be followed by Pastor Lyle, who will present our speaker to us. And then we move along on what we've had designed for today. Sister Camille, multitask, many, many hats. God has blessed her. This time now, she's coming to minister to us in song. Okay, Pastor Hannah's reminded me that maybe we should allow the children. Children, this is, as I said, children in grade 6 and below, we'd like you to be dismissed at this point. We have the Sunday school teachers and a team of persons ready to receive you and minister to you. Just one other announcement regarding the mealtime that I want to put in your hearing so you can begin to process it now. But we have two multi-purpose halls where we'll be sharing meals today, upstairs and downstairs. You know they're identical, but we want to encourage you to stay together as a family. I know we've had a pass where the children, the younger ones, went upstairs and older. We don't want that. We want families together, but we want to show preference to the more mature persons in the congregation not to go upstairs. So we encourage the families that have more senior persons to be accommodated downstairs, and the families with younger persons can trek up those stairs and enjoy the meal together. But stay together as much as possible as a family. Thank you.
This song is a reminder of the benefits and the beauty that we can have as family. Our immediate family, and of course our community, our church family. Whenever you're ready, Kava.
This is the way we were intended to be. shoulder in love. Well, I need you, and you need me, and together we'll face the world as God's forgiven family. We are children of one Father.
Thank you, Sister Camille. Well, good afternoon, church. Today, it's my privilege to be the one to introduce a great Bahamian. He is a psychiatrist, athlete, civic leader, musician, and a great Bahamian. Dr. Timothy Barrett is a Bahamian who has been practicing medicine for the past 39 years. He is a trained psychiatrist and currently holds a position of Director of Community Mental Health Services for the Public Hospitals Authority. He is a clinical tutor of psychiatry for the School of Clinical Medicine and Research in the Bahamas. Additionally, he is in private practice and is a managing director of Psychological Associates Limited, or PAL, a company which provides not only psychiatric services, but also employee assistance programs and training, especially in the area of human resource development. It's a lot to read here. I'm just going to pick up some stuff that I think you would appreciate as we would bring him forward. He has a distinction of being a Bahamian who has achieved the first gold medal in the history of the Bahamas in a field event when he won the triple jump in the Central American and Caribbean Games. You know, there's a tendency when we look at people, we kind of see them as one-dimensional. Well, he's had many dimensions to him. So when you look at him, never mind, some of you, old people have this habit, if they see a little bit of gray, they say you're old. Dr. Barrett, we never admit that we're old, we're just maturing, right? He went to the University of Southern California, where he contributed to their national championship in track and field in 1968, where he was an All-American in the same year. So he has done a great job. He is the first Bahamian to medal in the Central American and Caribbean track championships, winning the bronze medal in 1975. So when you hear me say he's an athlete, you can appreciate that. He has done many things in civics and sporting organizations, volleyball, Bahamas Sickle Cell Association, member of the Bahamas Association for the Physically Disabled, and on, the list goes. He's frequently used as a resource for lectures and seminars in managing stress, conflict management, and time management, as well as emotional management, leadership development, team building, and maintenance. He's been a visiting lecturer for the master's degree program for the University of the West Indies School of Business in Cave Hill, Barbados. And additionally, he has provided services for regional banks and government organizations throughout the Caribbean. He is keenly interested in the development of human beings to their highest capacity and is passionate about the effective use of that limited and shrinking resource known as time. Having been ordained to the sacred gospel ministry, he's a minister as well. He is very active in the church ministry at Camp Road Ministries, where he's an associate pastor and is responsible for marriage preparation and counseling along with leadership training. He is married to the former Samantha Adley, and though only two of their children are present, they have four children, Timothy Jr., Mark, Toriano, is that right? Toriano and Joel. Am I saying that right? All right, good. His areas of interest are music. Some of you will remember he took part in our multi-church presentation named the Easter Song. He was right there in the band pit making his contribution. He recently became the first Bahamian to achieve the LTCL in recital. Is that bass? Listening to jazz is also a hobby, squash, traveling, and visiting museums. Most recently, he became a member of the Bahamas National Symphony Orchestra, where he plays the bass or bass clarinet. How do you say that? Bass clarinet. Grace Community Church, stand to your feet and welcome with me Dr. Timothy Barrett, a great Bahamian and a man who has much to tell us today. Give him a warm Grace welcome.
Morning, Grace. It's indeed a pleasure and a privilege for me to be here this morning. And, well, this morning and this afternoon. And to share with you something about which I know a little. And hopefully you'll know a little bit more once I finish sharing. I am always honored and humbled when people ask me to speak, when they think I have something of value to share. As Pastor Lyle said, I'm familiar with Grace. I spent a lot of time practicing right up here on this podium, and the conductor of the National Symphony Orchestra is Douglas Sternquist, who's right there. I've known Tinkle Hannah for a very long time. Dion is my son's saxophone instructor. I don't know where he is. Where'd my son go? Oh, he stepped out. And I know a lot more.